First and foremost, I'm really humbled to be here today in such a distinguished audience. I know for sure that a good number of you deserve this award more than I do, and please don't be mad at me. You are amazing inventors, and the talks I've seen are just blow away interesting and great. But since I'm standing on the stage, I want to tell you a few words about what excites me, what drives me, and why I pick the projects that I choose. And I want to start with my genuine passion that makes me get up in the morning is to try to solve big societal problems. And I share this with almost all of you, of course. But the projects that I pick tend to be projects I'm really emotional about, and I really fall in love with, just like a small schoolboy. Let me start at school. This is my childhood. It's not me watching those movies. And I fell in love with cars at a very young age, and with this idea of cars driving themselves. And it was amplified when I was 18. I lost my best friend in a car accident in a split-second bad decision by his friend who killed both of them. And then I didn't do anything on cars for a while until 2004, when DARPA, the US government, launched something called the DARPA Grand Challenge. And the DARPA Grand Challenge was a robotic race sponsored by the US government, whose sole purpose it was to invent a car that could drive itself through the desert. And they promised $1 million to the team that could build such a car. In the first year, this competition, the results were unbelievably shockingly awful. The best team would drive only 7 miles. And the average team out of over 100 teams would not even do a single mile in an open, empty desert. That's when my juices started flowing and said, I can do better than that. And I started joining hundreds of teams in the world to try to invent something entirely new called a self-driving car. I pulled together an unlikely group of candidates to build my system called Stanford students. Rather than paying them, we gave them course credit. And in the next 2 months, they would work really hard to build the first iteration. And our first iteration was built in such a short amount of time, it was a miserable failure again. Here's our very first drive, and we got it stuck in mud and had to shovel it out. And a few weeks later, these pictures were taken, sadly, by the New York Times, who decided to print them. But what characterized us and all the other teams was a willingness for crazy rapid iteration. Build it, break it. Build it, break it. So Carnegie Mellon had a team, done a fantastic job. And from UC Berkeley, overseas from Stanford, we got this video. Let's see this face. This is Anthony Lewandowski. When we went out to build a car that could drive itself, it looked utterly impossible. But less than a year later, 5 teams had succeeded building a car that could drive 140 miles. Here's ours. And if you look very carefully in the very beginning, it almost crashes.
It was a
little moment when it swerved against a concrete wall. I can barely see it. The race itself was one of these races that I think now are really a little bit historical even, where the cars went out on their own, followed by a government-operated control vehicle. And we could just see in the control room what's happening and get some footage from helicopters. 130 miles, 7 hours, these cars drove in terrain that robots had never navigated before. In just below 7 hours, our vehicle Stanley arrived from this grueling race as the first to ever complete the DARPA Grand Challenge, netting Stanford at the time $2 million, of which, of course, my dean saw the lion's share, and propelled the robot itself into the Air and Space Museum. In fact, exhibition just opening right now on time and space in the Air and Space Museum and the mall, you can see the car. And that was my very first taste of self-driving cars, still a far cry away from what we do today. And since this is 99U, I want to emphasize a little bit the process that we did. We had two things going for ourselves. Number one was a completely impossible problem, but well-defined, and that really helped. And second was an eagerness to just build, fail, improve, build, fail, improve. And the truth of life is, if you just build, you fail, you learn, you improve, you build again, and do this long enough, eventually you succeed. It's true for everybody. It's a universal law, I think. So that's the law you have to keep in mind, I think, as you go forward. Every failure is a great opportunity to learn something new. And there's nothing better than learning in life. So when you fail, you should be celebrating. Most of us don't. Now, I got the chance to collect a few leads later after I helped Google with Street View and Google Maps to gather the most creative people in this field to build the next generation of self-driving car. And very importantly, before we hired a single person, we spent hours on end asking ourselves, what is a great milestone? And the reason why we did this is we didn't want to bring people in and say, you want to solve the world and do something very abstract. You want something very concrete. And we found something concrete with Larry and Sergey and Eric. And the concrete thing is we scoped out 1,000 miles on California highways and streets and downtowns, regular streets. We said, we're just going to make the car drive everywhere on all these 1,000 miles. And it looked like a complete impossible thing to do. Driving a self-driving car in traffic with other people around, small children, that's crazy. So it was a great thing to try. And we made predictions how long it would take to do this that lasted between 5 years and 20 years, depending whom you ask. And it took less than a year to get to the point where our first cars would kind of secretly drive through Palo Alto. Here's a video of a car driving through Palo Alto. No one had a clue what these cars were. Some thought it was a new wind generation energy system. Others thought they were looking for extraterrestrial life. The cars didn't quite drive flawlessly, but we had human drivers inside. And about 10 months later, we got to the point where we could just drive everywhere. And the next video is just a set of snapshots taken from the car as it drives to San Francisco, Monterey, Los Angeles, what have you. This is the kind of complexity of situations the car was able to handle even 2 years ago. See a jogger coming along, cars taking precaution, highways, it's a little bit fast forward, toll booths. This is Monterey, downtown areas, lots of pedestrians. We've really gotten to the point to do the impossible. And the methodology was the same. We had a very clear and crisp goal. And we iterated as fast as we could towards this goal. So if I look back a little bit on this project, or let me show you the last one. This is an example where I would like to have sound where we're actually able to take an actual passenger and make this person the driver of a self-driving car.
Hey, Nathaniel, how are you?
Doing just great.
Go ahead, Steve.
Auto driving.
Here we go.
Away we go. Look, Ma, no hands.
No hands anywhere.
No hands, no feet.
No hands, no feet, no nothing.
I love it. So we're here at the stop sign.
Yep.
Cars using radars and laser to check and make sure there's nothing coming either way.
I find myself looking.
Old habits die hard, man.
Hey, they don't die. Hey, anybody up for a taco?
Yeah. What do you want to do today, Steve?
I'm all for Taco Bell myself.
All right. Well, let's go get a taco at the drive-thru.
And we're turning into the parking lot.
Yeah.
How neat.
Go. Now I kind of creep along here. Does anybody have any money?
I've got money.
No, I've got my wallet right here. You can roll down your window and order a burrito.
Yeah, push that. I'm doing very well. How are you today? This is some of the best driving I've ever done.
Percent of my vision is gone. I'm well past legally blind. You lose your timing in life. Everything takes you much longer. There are some places that you cannot go. There are some things that you really cannot do. Where this would change my life is to give me the independence and the flexibility to go the places I both want to go and need to go. when I need to do those things.
I give a lot of speeches about the big vision, and I give very few speeches about the way to get there. And I looked back in preparation of this presentation as to how my life looked in the last decade in this field, and I found my life is very binary. There were actually moments where I made amazing progress and moments where I made no progress at all. And they come almost by the year, and it's really sad to admit this in public. Now, of course, the award is secured, so I can talk about it. But it's interesting, I can correlate with some very simple feature of these projects that make all the difference. And there goes about as follows. In the first beginning, we argued what to do. And then DARPA came along, gave us a goal and said, do this. We just did it. Okay? Then we argued more for an entire year, and instead we made no progress whatsoever. And then the urban challenge came along another race, and we just did it. Then we didn't do anything for a while. And then in 2009, Google came along and said, let's pick 1,000 miles, just do it. There's almost a beauty in just knowing where you're going. And I see so many teams getting stuck in the discussion where to go. That can be good in the beginning, but once it's set, it's really good to maintain ship. For me, it's a factor of 10 in execution speed, just to set that direction very crisply and very clearly. Let me say a few words about another project, Glass, which I have my head here. Around that time, when the self-driving car became public, Larry, Sergey, Vic Gondotra, Babak Pavitz, and I got together thinking there ought to be something interesting in the mobile space. We all moved from mainframe computers to desktops, PC, all the way to tablets and phones, but we felt there should be a generation of compute platform that should be more advanced than this. There should be something coming afterwards. And this picture came up in our mind about evolution of compute platforms. On the right, you see Sergey. On the left, you see Sergey's grandfather. To see if you could build something that will really enable us to be in physical contact with the world, free us up, but have access to all the digital world at the same time. And phones do a good job, but taking out the phone of your pocket is a fairly tedious thing. It distracts you. It takes about 40 seconds to even take a picture, unlock the phone, get the camera started. So we really wanted to see, can we invent something that goes beyond this? And it's one of these kind of impossible tasks. It's really hard in this jungle of technology and user interfaces to find the right focus. But we only made one decision. We wanted to build a device that people wear all day. Okay, so a wearable device for all day. Now it turns out there have been people around wearing devices all day for a long time. You could find them at MIT, exactly 6 people. So these 6 people, gang of 6, had been wearing devices. And there was just one thing wrong with these devices, which is they didn't quite feel right. So in the next 2 years, we went through a whole bunch of iterations, and key credit goes to Babak Pavitz and Isabel Olsen, our designer. Where we really went and tried to develop a concept in that space that's logical, okay? We had our goal, has to be wearable all day. This was the first version, Thad Stana from Georgia Tech, wearing a backpack, it weighs about 2 kilograms. And then we strapped literally cell phones on our heads. Then we bought a 3D printer and made it a little bit smaller, it's still 150 grams, until finally the concept emerged that we have to the present day. That's actually our head designer, Isabel Olsen. And she designed this device over here. It's a full PC, dual core, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, battery included, display, camera, head tracking unit, and GPS. So lots of stuff in there. So that's basically Google Glass as you know it today, and it's just been hitting the market. Some of you might be lucky enough to be among the chosen few that responded to If I Had Glass hashtag. Now, interesting thing from the perspective of execution was it was an insanely logical process. And the logic started out with the idea it should be worn all day. And once you realize it has to be worn all day, there's a whole bunch of things you can't do. It can't be heavy. It can't have a wire. So So to make it lightweight. If you make it lightweight, you realize you have only one display, not two displays are too heavy. When there's one display and you want to wear it all day, you better move it above your visual field as opposed to into your visual field, otherwise you're going to be distracted all the time. It's going to feel annoying. And once you've done this, you realize if something above your visual field, it has to be a small field of view, because otherwise your eyes hurt when you're using it. And the most important, but you have to make it valuable and find applications that really carry you through the day. And the idea of a camera and experience sham was born out of this desire, because augmented reality, which is the other technology that looks appealing, is something we likely won't do all day long, and there will likely not be as much of a reason to wear it. So we focus on experience sharing and notification and so on. The reason why I want to say this is one of the people that influences me the most, Elon Musk, and I have enormous respect for Elon. Elon very clearly articulated what I believe to be the case is about thinking and logic and decision making. He contrasts two different things, reasoning by analogy and reasoning by logic. And reasoning by logic is first principles. And he finds that a lot of people reason by analogy. It's been always this way, it has to be this way. Why we do this this way? Well, it's always been this way. Most of us reason by analogy, and it's very hard to reason by logic, but once you reason by logic by first principles, you arrive at totally different solutions, and glass certainly being one of those, some of different solutions from past mobile solutions. That's something I carry with me every single day. Every single day I strive to think logically, ask what's really happening in society, what are really the problems, and then derive my decisions from that. I don't always succeed, but that's what I aspire to do. These days, I work on something new, on education, and I'm not going to talk too much about it. I feel that higher education is another big field that needs change, just like transportation and mobile devices. It's being organized inefficiently, it's become way too expensive, it's not easily accessible, it's hidden behind brick and mortar universities. And we started working on a company called Udacity, which some of you might know, that puts massive open online classes, thank you, online. Our first class had 160,000 students. Our Intro to CS computer science class just surpassed 300,000 students, which means this class last year taught more students computer science than all professors in the world combined. And it's a journey, again, which I think we can only solve with very crisp logical thinking and very clear objectives and goals. And I've put together a nice team that's really pushing forward, trying to develop the next generation of learning tools and assessment tools. And who knows, maybe 2 or 3 years from now, I'd be in the lucky situation to report we've changed all of education, the way we're trying to change all of transportation, and hopefully at some point mobile devices. Now, in concluding my short remarks, I want to point out some of my basic thinking about innovation. And this picture summarizes it better than anything else I can say. This is a mountain scene. I actually happen to like mountain hiking and climbing and backcountry skiing. And the process for me to do something interesting is very much like the process of climbing a mountain. Some of us start companies to get rich. You don't climb a mountain to spend much time on the top. You climb a mountain because you like the process of climbing. So when you climb a mountain for innovation, you should pick a mountain that you like climbing, not just a mountain where you like to be on top of. When you pick a mountain, something you want to do, you're going to be stuck with this for the next couple of years. So you better pick one you really, really like. Okay? Now, in innovation land, every mountain has previously never been climbed before, so there's no known route. So you have to make up the route as you go. Really important to me is that you pick milestones along the way that are absolutely clear milestones and you agree with everybody on. The moment you have that agreement, life becomes much easier. I've seen a lot of entities where half of the team believes they're climbing this mountain, and the other half be climbing this mountain. It's extremely painful to do this. Once you've done this, you need a team that trusts each other. Even when you begin climbing the mountain, the weather might be perfect, you will come into a ferocious storm, and you have to survive the storm. And trust, to me, has always been a bidirectional thing. It's not just that people trust me because I'm the CEO. They trust me because I serve them, and I help them, and I empower them. And trust is always earned. It's never bestowed. So trust is a process you have to build up. For me, building up trust in my team to me and for me, for my team members, is one of the most important things I do, always do. So when the storm hits, I can go on and trust blindly my team that that's the right thing. And then the thing not to do is to quibble about the path up. When you climb a mountain that you never climbed before, you cannot predict what the path is. You might not even see the summit at all times. You have to keep the summit in mind and be excited. But you can only decide what to do next tomorrow morning. That's the only decisive power you have. So you have to work from day to day to day and react to things. And you might climb false summits and have to turn around a little bit. And that's okay. That's your fast failure. If you spend too much time thinking about which path to go, then you burn up all your energy, you'll never agree, and it's going to be a disaster. So all my projects are of the type where I pick a mountain, be it 1,000 miles driving in California, or build a head-mounted device you can wear all day, or putting an entire new education system in place. And that summit is unmovable, but the path is up to daily surprise. So this is one of my few speeches I ever given about execution. But these simple principles of logic, clear milestones and clear vision, willingness to experiment really fast and fail fast and celebrate failures, and then have a team that you really trust, those are the ones that work for me. And that can be applied to any perspective of life. It could be applied to small things, I don't know how to clean my car, or it could be applied to big things, how to change society. Generally, I have a tendency to put my time more into how to change society than how to clean my car. I do clean my car occasionally. And when you do this, I think with this recipe, pretty much any problem can be solved. All of you can solve all problems. Thank you.
We get stools. Thanks. I have a million questions, but I'll ask a few. So what are the criteria for choosing which project Google X will focus on? With all that brain power you have to channel, how do you know which mountain to climb?
There's a very small number of criteria. Number one, we need a moonshot. We need something that looks insanely hard, technologically hard. So we're really into technologies. And then number two is we need a team that we believe can execute. And the team we typically recruit at the time the moonshot is being defined. And typically we find a single leader. In Google Glass, it was Babak Pavitz from the University of Washington. And then we hire that leader together with all his friends. So there's a trust relationship. And when that is done, we tend to set a milestone and say, this is the direction you go, and then leave them alone. There's nothing that engineers want more than autonomy. And there's nothing more progress-killing than micromanagement on the top. So I always found, just leave them alone, I can go on vacation and have a good life and still make progress.
Now, how you have a lot of resources at your disposal and a ton of creativity in the team and probably throughout Google, how do you keep people focused?
I think the death of many projects is just too many ideas. I mean, if you look at how many ideas really make a good product, it might be two or three. And if you look at how many ideas engineers produce, it's two or three a week. So most of it is exercise in just saying no to ideas. And the nice thing, if you climb a mountain as a group of people and you really want to go to the summit, and you're being reminded every day, every step, by nature, by the terrain, what the real problems are, and you keep, say, launch a product, keep iterating, then there's actually no space for ideas that defocus you. Everything is derived from actual problems in the field. If you keep that loop going, then every idea that comes along is usually a good idea.
Okay, so how about, there were a lot of folks who spoke today and yesterday who talked about accountability. And they talked, are you looking at answers right now?
Hi. Let me take a picture of you. Great. Yep.
All right. A lot of folks talked about accountability, the importance
Pardon?
Of what?
Excuse me?
Oh, were you distracted? A lot of folks talk about accountability and how they shared ideas prematurely as a good way of getting feedback and people holding them to what they were working on. How quickly do you share what Google X is working on, whether it's internally within the company, employees, and more broadly? And do you want to do it quickly, or do you wait? And what's your thinking around that?
My general attitude is to share as broadly as we can early on. There was a speaker this morning who very nicely said, look, all this kind of secrecy of NDA just sets you back because you need other people's input to improve your ideas. Now, Google is big enough a place where there's enough smart engineers where you can really get traction for an idea before you go to the public. For some reason, Google the public likes to pick up on Google and report what they're doing, so what we're doing, so we kind of keep it a little bit quiet. And we love to get the moment where we have the public discussion when the product is basically ready or close to ready. But internally, there's a huge number of discussions, and they're always great. One of the key recipes, however, is to find the day when you stop the discussion. So when the project starts and we set a milestone, we tend to stop the discussion so that people can execute.
Mm-hmm. Now, how about, you know, I think about Google and I think about 90%+ of the revenues of the company coming from the search business. And then I think about, okay, driverless cars, Google Glass, the things that you're focused on. How do you get the rest of the company to rally around something that is just not directly related to revenue, at least not yet?
I have yet to meet a single Googler who would say what you guys are doing is not good because of lack of a revenue relationship. Google is an amazing company. And Google is one of these companies, every company where the DNA of the company is really given by the founders, by Sergey and Larry. And both of them are extremely curious, deep thinkers who really want to propel society. Both of them are just waiting, burning to do more than just one thing. And they've proven this in the past with Android and other products and Gmail, where they've been very successful. But they're now in the position that they can really take what they have and leverage into really massively new innovations. Now, a self-driving car, I would argue, is related to revenue, not revenue today, but to revenue tomorrow. And if you look at companies that don't make it over the decades, and there's very few companies that, in technology that are, say, 60, 70 years old. All those companies who make it reinvent themselves. Mm-hmm. And they need to reinvent themselves because every market you have is only a market for a certain amount of time. Google understands this unbelievably well. I can tell you the push for Google X came straight from Eric, Larry, and Sergey. And they have been the most strong proponents. And the Google board has very strongly endorsed what's happening. The money spent is certainly an investment. It gives certainly positive aspirations to the world, what Google is doing. But we are really serious about trying to harvest this back into revenue in the future.
And so do you think that the case has to be made then that there will be revenue in order to pursue one of these projects, or do you think that is not even necessary within that culture?
I never really argue that. I think it's really great to solve a societal problem, and if you have a big impact on society, you will eventually also make some money. I mean, it seems to be logical to me. If you don't make money, you probably have no impact. So. But it's not on the thinking, so we never discuss that. Mm-hmm.
So a lot of these ideas certainly first seemed crazy, and some people might still think they're crazy. Are we going to wear these glasses around? How do you deal with doubters? And your team especially, that probably saw a lot of the press saying, oh, you know, some people at first said, no, I would never wear that. How does one deal with doubters?
The world is crazy. I mean, the fact that we're sitting here is crazy. My voice could carry to the room is crazy. If you play Microsoft Kinect, it's crazy. You can wave your hand and it does something. It's like everything is crazy. Almost anything you do today. Like I have a 5-year-old child who was able to operate an iPod before he was able to walk, right? Then when he puts in the magazine and does this and doesn't work, he thinks the magazine is broken. Like, what are you talking about? We're living in this amazing world where all the laws seem to change and it's just amazing. I mean, flying cars, what have you. All this stuff is feasible. In fact, all it makes sense. When people doubt, there's different types of doubters, right? I come from a country in Germany where lots of people are very doubtful in general of everything. And that's maybe the reason why I don't live there anymore. But sometimes people doubt because they have technical reasons and they have an argument, right? And sometimes they doubt just because they can't imagine. They're too much in analogy. Like we've done our agriculture by hand yesterday, so we have to do the same tomorrow. I can tell you in education, I'm full of doubters that tell me the one-on-one contact with the professor is so absolutely essential. They have no data. They just believe what's happened in the last 1,000 years has to happen next 1,000 years. But that's the nice thing about Silicon Valley. Think logical. What do you do with these people that doubt? I'm happy to have a drink with them, and not a second drink, I guess.
After the third drink, you might get right on there.
And they come back a few years later and say, oh my God, what happened? So, okay.
Bye. So, you know, another, and we'll end on this question. What is, you know, is there a secret sauce, you know, that distinguishes great inventors, whether it's in the mindset or whether it's in the work ethic? I mean, what would you say is one of those things that you've observed amongst the other folks that you know that are serial inventors?
Oh my God, I don't think of myself as an inventor. I think that almost any idea that I have was behead by somebody else in my team, in my environment, and I just listened and copied it or stole it, as Picasso/Steve Jobs used to say. I think it's much more for me about execution, about streamlining, about getting things done. Almost all ideas are there. Just read Jules Verne or go to the science fiction movies. You find a lot of stuff there. In fact, there's way too many ideas to work on at the same time, to be honest. That's actually the main problem here. I think the 99% quote is right on target. It's really about how to organize things. And I think there's simple recipes to make things happen that really focus the team and let it execute at maximum velocity. So I don't know. I feel maybe I didn't win the award very rightfully, but I don't really invent. I just make things happen.
It's the execution award,
yeah.
And you execute. So keep on executing. And Sebastian, thank you so much for
thank you.
For being here, and congratulations.
Thank you.